Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadrow, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Patrick Morin. Patrick is a partner with Transact Capital Partners, a Richmond, Virginia-based investment banking firm that specializes in mergers and acquisitions of privately held companies with enterprise values up to $250 million. While Transact serves clients in multifamily technology, cybersecurity, warfare, and logistics industry, it specializes in staffing companies. He was also one of the founding partners for Bright Hammer LLC, a global consulting engaged by private equity groups, board of directors, and CEO to improve the performance of their investment companies. Prior to his current engagement, he was 7 years as senior vice president with Cornerstone Realty Income Trust, Inc., in a New York Stock Exchange traded company that owned and operated over 24,000 apartments. For two decades, Mr. Morin was an instructor with world-renowned Dale Carnegie Training. He was ranked among the top three instructors globally and was a member of the Elite Global Delivery Team. While a member of the National Speakers Association, he personally conducted thousands of keynotes and training meetings for businesses, associations, and government agencies. While he has spoken to staffing associations around the country, he says the coolest gig was to NASA. Mr. Morin appears on television, radio, and in print as an authority in his field. He has also appeared in Forbes and on CNBC. At some point, all owners of staffing companies will want to retire or exit their business. In today's Industry Insider session, you will learn the critical factors that CEOs have used when successfully selling their companies. Patrick will cover the requirements of an exceptional exit, including understand the two levers in which validations are driven, dial in on the pre-sale moves that maximize the profitability of a successful exit, learn to avoid the critical mistakes that drive down valuations, and uncover the keys to managing and negotiating with your investment banker. With that, I will turn the floor over to Patrick. Welcome.
Thank you so much. I really do appreciate that, Amanda. And I'm thrilled to be here. I'm thrilled to have been invited. So thank you.
You're welcome.
Grateful. And thank you all for taking some time out this afternoon to talk about one of our favorite subjects, which is the exit of our staffing company, especially coming out of the past year. There's certainly been a lot of interest in this particular subject. And we entitled it today, Don't Gamble It All Away. I'm going to get into that a little bit more in just a couple of moments. But this will be a fairly interactive session, so I am more than happy to have you drop into the chat and the Q&A over on the side of your screen any questions that you might have along the way. And also, at the end, I'm going to provide you with some contact information for me, so that way, if you want to privately send over a question, I'll be more than happy to answer that. I was telling a group a couple of weeks ago that I am the guy that everybody wants to talk to, but nobody wants to be seen with. And that is because everybody wants to know about how to exit their companies, how to sell their staffing companies, but they don't want to be seen with me because then everybody will know that they're actually doing it. So it's a precarious position for me. Just to tell you very quickly about Transact Capital, who we are, and offer you a little bit of credibility. We are a 20-year-old investment bank with five offices, including offices up in Chicago and down in Orlando. If any of you are out in Colorado, I am desperately looking for office space out there so I can be a little bit closer to the mountains and ski. We are 18 investment bankers, We've done well over 300 transactions, most of which are in the staffing space. So we are human capital management experts, staffing as well as perm placement and PEOs. We're in the middle of a host of transactions on those as well right now. We do focus in on middle market sell side M&A. So that is companies typically under $250 million, which fortunately for us includes every staffing company basically in the United States. There's 19,000 of you, and only about 161 of those are actually over $100 million. So you're right in our sweet spot. We are sponsors of various CEO organizations as well, and members of the Virginia Council of CEOs. The one thing that's a differentiator for our firm is that most of my partners and I, we have all of our bankers, we have owned companies before, and we've had our own exits. So we really do understand the nuances of being an owner that wants to sell their company. And one of the big differentiators too is that we are not a business broker. We are actually an investment banker. And the difference on that is that we are FINRA and SIPC licensed. So we can do a lot more complex transactions, and we do it under the auspices of the SEC. So it adds to a little bit more of our credibility on that. As I said earlier, we have a deep expertise in staffing M&A, but I can share that with you a little bit later on, just some of our current deals, and I'm sure you've heard about some of those most recently. But the title of the talk today is Don't Gamble It All Away. And the reason why we picked this topic, I was speaking to a staffing association actually out in Las Vegas when we all could travel. But the great thing about it is that when we were out there in the world and making things happen for our own companies, one of the things that we started to notice as investment bankers is that we assiduously build our companies over 10, 20, 30 years. And we build these amazing staffing companies with wonderful employees and terrific clients that are resilient and bounce back. And then when it comes to exiting, all of a sudden we get it in our heads that we want to make this thing happen and happen, you know, very quickly. And a lot of times what will happen is that owners of staffing companies and PEOs and permanent placement companies and hybrids like that, what they do is that they've taken so much time to build out their company that they didn't actually plan out their exit. And what they end up doing is they end up gambling with the valuation of their company. And that makes it really, really tough at the end, because this is going to be a significant part of your post-work life net worth. And so we decided to focus in on that theme of you don't have to gamble it away. There's a couple of things that you can do a few years ahead or even a year ahead of your exit that's going to add to the value of your organization and make sure that you are exiting for pretty close to the maximum amount that you can exit for, given timing and size and other things like that. So that's exactly what I'm going to be covering here today. Is I'm going to be focusing in on what are the things that you can specifically do ahead of time to prepare your company for the maximum exit, so you and your kids and your grandkids, your progeny, can benefit from your lifetime of work. I'm going to keep it relatively simple, but I do encourage your questions as you go along the way, and then I'm going to present to you a gift towards the end of this, which I think you'll appreciate. So the first thing I do want to do, though, is it would be, I know that we're all over webinars, right? I mean, it's just like we got a year of webinars going on, and it's like, okay, I'm going to go spend another 59 minutes on another webinar. But it is very important, because we have to take a look at the year in retrospect and then look forward, because we are entering a very strong market for selling staffing companies, for making these exits. But it's worthwhile to take a look at where we have been first. And frankly, this past year is like surfing these big Hawaii waves, you know? Everybody's sitting there trying to figure out how to survive. What are we doing with PPP money? How do I actually find people to fill orders? Our fill rates are tanking only because we don't have access to that labor pool. We've got, we've got people who used to work for us pretty robustly. Now they're staying home and they're collecting some of those dollars. It makes it harder. Our revenue and our earnings are starting to drop. So, you know, the fact that you got this far, the fact that you survived this and you're doing it now speaks volumes about you, because there's three things that happen to people during this entire COVID debacle. Either staffing companies went out of business, or they ended up just kind of floating along and staying. But there is a select group of staffing companies, you guys, that absolutely have thrived through this. And a lot of them are even within logistics or the food industry. If you are so beneficial, if you are the beneficiary of that, that's awesome for you. You're still here, so you're surviving. That's also good. So now let's try to figure out what we're going to do from this point to the time that you retire to your exit to really make it work. But let me share with you some of our observations. At a very high level, so starting last year, M&A, mergers and acquisitions, and the sales of staffing companies was really robust. It was very high, and there was a lot of activity going on. And then, boom, in March, the world pretty much stopped, and it held off for, you know, obviously those 2 months or so. But in mid-June, the buyers of these companies, including private equity and some of the strategics, they came back. And even since then, they are now on fire and actively hunting for companies that they could acquire. Now, there's a couple of things that are going on with that in terms of M&A. And the first thing is that performance, buyers are definitely being given a credit for a path back to pre-COVID performance. You would think that obviously with earnings going down over the last year for most companies, usually on average about 20 to 25%, some a little more, some a little less, some had a little uptick depending on where they were. But what's interesting is that buyers are giving credit for a path back to pre-COVID performance, but you're gonna have to prove it. And I'll be talking about that a little bit later on. Multiples. Generally, the multiples have been holding steady, but the all-cash transaction is really a pre-COVID deal structure. So therefore, even if you sell now, it's probably not going to be for all cash, which we all want to. It will be structured, and we can talk about that as well. Projections, you know, even in these turbulent times, what we are seeing is that the buyers want projections that are going out. Now, everybody on this call knows that looking really beyond 2 or 3 years, it's an eight ball. It's a crystal ball, and nobody really knows what that's going to hold. However, having a game plan for the next year out and knowing where your revenue is going to be coming from and what your relationship with your customers are, very, very important, especially as you're going to sell your company. You're going to be asked for a look that's at least 3 years out as well. But those projections are the things that are going to really help you add to the valuation of your company. Okay. PPP loans, you know, guidance released back by the SBA in October, they took us out of a gray area. I will tell you is that you might be feeling really cash rich right now. Some of you feel cash rich. Some of you applied it to your employees and kept them afloat. Good thing. Obviously, what it was for, some of us, we didn't necessarily have that problem, but we had that money anyway. What I will tell you is that because you have that cash, it doesn't necessarily drop down to your EBITDA. We'll talk about your earnings in a little bit. But the point being is that you won't get a multiple on those PPP loans. What we will tell you is to go ahead and try to, as soon as you are capable, eligible, try to get the forgiveness on the PPP loans, the first one and the second one if you took it. Try to get those taken care of. In terms of technology, obviously, I would normally be in front of your event. I would have flown out to wherever we were going to be meeting, and we'd be having this conversation in person, but we're not. We're doing it via WebEx. And almost all of the transactions that our firm has done in the last year have been by Zoom meeting. We're selling, you know, $50 million companies where the buyer and the seller have never actually been in the same room. And when you start looking at the technology that's coming into the staffing industry, everything from the back of the house elements straight up to the recruiting, the companies that are really commanding some value are the companies that have brought on that technology and are leveraging it to help them fill those orders. And then the last thing that I will tell you in terms of some of the observations, workers' comp is still an issue. And that is, we're still looking at it, making sure that your mod rate, you know, is hovering around a one or lower if you can. If it's a little bit higher, making sure that you've got the right categories in terms of making sure you've got the right application of where they are. Really manage your workers' comp. Super, super important, because it's going to come up in M&A. Now, with that in mind, why are people considering selling right now? Why is there such an interest in this? We have a bunch of people on this webinar. Why is that? I think everybody sees that the capital gains taxes could be increasing from 20% to almost 40%. Dependent on not just this election, but the midterm election that's actually coming up, because that's going to be very important. You know, when you have state added taxes, you could be giving up to 45% of your gains on that company. So there are a lot of people rushing to market before there's any movement on that cap gains tax. Right now, we've got numerous buyers out there, guys. A lot of them, private equity, strategics. We've got individuals who've got some what we call dry powder, $1 trillion in money that has to be spent, and so therefore they're looking around to put it to work, and what they're looking for is quality companies to be able to buy. There are fewer numbers of companies right now to actually acquire. Everybody's starting to come into the pool, so the earlier that you're in the pool, probably the better, because it's certainly going to get you a little bit more attention. But the upshot of it is that everybody is trying to rebuild their businesses, so looking forward, they can maximize that valuation. But we're really at that inflection point where the economy is about to start opening up, but the buyers are already here for us. And also, you know, why are people looking to sell? Low interest rates creates opportunities for sellers. Buyers can fund acquisitions for very little, for the cost of money is very, very low. And so therefore they are flush with cash and they're looking to buy. Sellers can obviously take advantage of that. Just makes sense. We're all pretty good on economics here. So now let's get into, with that kind of setting the table, let's start getting into not gambling it away and how to maximize the value of your exit from this point forward. And what I'm thinking is that because you've joined us, you're probably thinking about exiting sometime either this year or at least within the next 3 years or so. Chances are, if you're thinking about exiting 20 years from now, you're not on this call. If you are, you're super smart. But at the same time, most people, it's already kind of bridging the gap and saying, all right, I'm not really sure I feel like going through another one of these things. Let me test the market and see if anybody's willing to buy me. Or the other thing is that people are already starting to call you saying, hey, would you sell? We'll talk a little bit more about that. My objective for the remainder of this thing is for you to be able to jot down some notes on things that you can do immediately to be able to increase the value of your firm. Okay. So I'm a little bit different than most investment bankers. A friend of mine calls me his enlightened investment banker. And it's because not everything to me equates to, you know, all about the transaction. I really do look at kind of the bigger picture of things. And so oftentimes I will share with you, I will open up the cloak and share with you the secrets of investment banking. At the end, I'm going to tell you how to negotiate with your investment banker. But I like to share these things because I think the more informed that a seller, that a CEO or a founder is on exiting their company, I think the smarter you are about it, the better we all work in concert. So investment bankers always try to make this black box, like, I'm going to sell your company, but I'm not going to really tell you exactly how I'm going to go and do it. I'm just going to straight up tell you. The more you know, the better off that you are. All companies are sold based on two fundamental things. The first one is risk, and the second one is return. That's it. It's not really much harder than that. And it's the perception of the risk versus the return that someone is going to get from operating your company. And this just makes sense to all of us who've ever invested in the stock market or anything. What we're trying to do is we're trying to get the most amount of money back for the least amount of risk. And so everything that I say on this webinar from this point forward is going to be framed in the idea of either what you're doing generating a return, or is it ameliorating risk for the potential buyer? Because the more return you have and the less risk, that's when you're maximizing your return and when you go to exit the company. And that is how you get buyers to pay more. So be thinking of that. Super simple, really easy. Is the decision that I'm about to make going to increase the return on this company as measured by EBITDA, as measured by net income, or is it going to reduce the risk that we're going to be able to make those dollars? Pretty simple. Doesn't have to be much more complicated than that. So now we'll focus in into the investment banking world about how companies are valued. Okay? How companies are valued. And all valuations start off with what we call free cash flow, or EBITDA. EBITDA is a really good substitute for free cash flow. You probably talk to your accountant about it, you know, at least once a quarter. But that is the very first element that a company, that a buyer is going to be asking me about. Is they're going to say, what is the revenue on the company and what is the EBITDA? What is that free cash flow that's throwing off? And so it's real simple. It is effectively your operating earnings. And then what we do is we go ahead and add back any interest expense or income taxes, depreciation and amortization. We get an EBITDA number. And then if you're using the company as a lifestyle business, meaning you bought your Maserati in it, or you have your houseboat in it, or you take vacations to the south of France because you want to study staffing over in Europe, we are going to go ahead and add those expenses back to be able to get your EBITDA to a pretty big number. And that EBITDA is going to be the foundation of the valuation of your company. And the important thing to remember on that is this: size matters. Larger companies command larger price multiples. It's as simple as that. A company that is generating $2 million in EBITDA is worth more than a company generating $250,000 in EBITDA. So in this case, the one thing that I would tell you is that the more free cash flow that you are generating, the more valuable you are. And where this really has an impact is that when you start crossing that $1.5 million to $2 million threshold for EBITDA, that's when a lot of the private equity guys will come in and look at you and go, wow, that company could be a platform. And a platform is the first investment into a space. It could be their first investment into the staffing industry. Smaller things like that can also be tuck-ins. And that is, they just tuck your company in to a platform that they already have. But the important thing for us to remember as founders and CEOs of staffing companies is the more that we grow out that EBITDA, the more valuable our company is. And it just makes sense because large companies usually can eliminate some of those discount factors, you know, in terms of risk on the business and the financials. They have a stronger infrastructure. Usually they've got a team, or they've got, things that are in place that allow the company to operate independently alone. And it's perceived that they have less risk. So without even knowing anything else about this webinar, knowing nothing else, what you know is the bigger you grow your company, not only the more it's worth, but that is going to get multiplied by a bigger number. And so instead of exiting for a 4x multiple, you might be exiting for a 5x multiple or a 6x multiple. So it kind of grows on two fronts. So you do whatever you possibly can in the 3 years going up to your exit to grow EBITDA and to show those growth rates. So So if you're looking at metrics that you want to measure on a regular basis, I would be looking at sales and I would absolutely revenues, and I would be looking at the growth rate of your EBITDA and keep a real close eye on that, because it ends up being a good conversation for you. So what makes a company worth a lot more? So you got some indicators of high value. One of those indicators, increasing sales and earnings. Whenever we see this going up, and we'll talk about COVID here momentarily, but whenever we see sales and earnings go up, that is a fundamental indicator of a strong company. We're selling 2 tech staffing firms right now, and the growth rates on these companies are almost vertical. They almost look like a takeoff of the space shuttle. And immediately, some of the biggest private equity guys are looking at these things saying, yeah, we want these companies as our platform. So really be looking at your sales and earnings as a percentage and what they're increasing. And look at it month over month, meaning same store sales this year versus last year. And it should be pretty good, you know, relative to last year. You should see some huge numbers on there, but also annually. High sustainable cash flow. We talked about that. There's room for the business to grow. You've got a business niche. You've got a competitive advantage. There's barriers to entry. History and reputation, very important. These are things that we guard. We're about to get an additional turn, meaning an additional multiple, because of the reputation of one of the companies that we are representing. It was that important for one of the buyers. So be looking at your history and your reputation. And if there's anything that you can do in order to amend that, start now, because it can turn into something really valuable. Key strong management structure. I'm going to go about this ad nauseum in just a moment. But also modern, well maintained facilities or equipment. And if you've gone virtual and now you are virtual and you got rid of your offices, we're seeing a lot of staffing companies do that, that you have in place the means and method by which you are contacting your recruiters, by which you're contacting your labor, that you're following up with them, that you're at least meeting virtually, and you have that identified. So these are usually indicators of high value. The more of them you have, the higher the value of the company you have. Right? But now let's really get into it, because you have, I've gone through the top of the house. So when we go to sell a company, the first hurdle that we hit is going to be that EBITDA number. And so we're looking at the EBITDA and we're adding back as many of the expenses as we can to increase that EBITDA, because that's going to put you within a category of a multiple, right? Just makes sense. Then what happens is this: the buyer will take that multiple, right, against your EBITDA, the multiply, and they'll say, I'm willing to pay this amount for this company. But then what they do is they start looking in at some of the risk factors that can bang up that multiple. Because remember, their objective is exactly the opposite of yours. Their objective is to pay as little for the company as they possibly can. Your objective is to get them to pay as much for the company as they possibly can. How do you get to do that? You do that by eliminating those risk factors and presenting forth and saying, yeah, this is a really good, this company has really terrific earnings, and I've mitigated the risk factors. So I'm going to give them to you in the order that we are asked them almost every single day. The first question that we get from almost every buyer is, tell me about the team that is not the CEO. So your number one consideration for selling your company is this: do you have a group of smart, hardworking lieutenants that are behind you that add material value and facilitates that smooth exit, right? If you could focus in on the one thing that is going to really impact the risk profile of your company, is, do you have a strong number two? A secret way that we ask this about companies, if I ever get on the telephone with you, I will ask you, hey, when was the last time you took a vacation? And the warning flag that we look for is someone who goes, oh my God, I haven't taken a vacation in years. This place would fall apart without me. If we hear those words or something like it, There's a really good chance we're probably not going to represent the company because it means that the company is so unstable that it really isn't generating its own cash flow to be sustainable. The risk profile is really, really high. The best thing that we like to hear is, oh, I took 6 weeks off and I went to the Greek islands on a cruise and I called in once a week to make sure my team, you know, was on track. That is a great answer. So focus in on having a competent succession team. Make sure that the people that are helping you run this company can absolutely run the company when you are not necessarily there. Make sure that they're trained up. Make sure that they understand the business and understand the numbers. Because when we go to sell your company, we're gonna put your inner circle on display. And what'll happen is that if the buyer thinks that you are the primary driver of the business, that multiple that we talked about a couple of minutes ago is going to get banged up and it's going to come down. So have an extraordinarily strong, successful team around you and constantly feed that. The next one is clean financials. I added this for a little bit of humor here, but really I cannot overemphasize the importance of having clean financials. And I'm going to explain some things for you. Focusing on those good, clean financials and good business practices. And what I mean by that is that if all of your financials, when you go through a transaction, every transaction is going to look back at least 3 years. 3 years is the normal. And so they're going to be able to see income statement and balance sheet and statement of cash flows for the last 3 years. They're also going to see your tax returns because nobody likes to lie on their tax returns. And so what they're going to try to do is they're going to try to tie, the buyer will tie your tax return to your income statement, right? And they're going to see whether or not these two things match over here. And so if you've got some suspect expenses that are on your books, go ahead and try to clean those things up, as quickly as you can. If you are putting on there your kid's college education and it's not necessarily, related to the business or other things like that, get with your accountant as soon as you can and keep those financials really, really clean and get them scrubbed. Because the one thing that will happen is that if you are a company of any size, and you are being bought by one of the larger firms, either strategic or on private equity, definitely on private equity, you're going to go through what's called a quality of earnings. You're going to hear me talk about it like a Q of E, quality of earnings. That's what it is. And that, everyone, it is just what it is, a financial enema. That's all it is. They're going to look at everything and pull it all out. And it's pretty far down the path. I mean, you already have an agreement to be sold, but I will tell you is that when you get to the quality of earnings, you've already committed to a particular buyer. Now they're really going to go through and do their due diligence. They're going to look at the quality of that earnings. So their accountants are going to go through your books and you want to make sure that your books are really clean and they're in good order. If they're not, they will, in the transaction process, they will find it. They will find out. And then between the letter of intent and the closing documents, they'll try to beat us all up. Remember, I'm on your team on this one. So they're going to try to beat us up and get a lower price and say, oh, your financials really aren't clean. So 3 years ahead of your exit, or if you're thinking about it before 3 years, like if you're thinking about exiting this year, really do a three-year look back on your financials with your accountant. Make sure that your financials are really solid, really clean. Now, when you sell your company, there are three types of financial statements that accountants offer. They are compiled, they are reviewed, and they are audited. Those are the three. And the bigger the company is, normally they start moving towards reviewed and audited. I'll explain all three of these things. Smaller companies typically have compiled. But you'll also understand that which one of those you choose also ameliorates risk to the buyer, makes you more attractive, and increases your multiple to some degree. So compiled financial statements, really simple. You take all your receipts, you throw them in a box, you throw them at your accountant puts them in order and sends you back financial statements and your tax return and says, here you go, I put it all together. That's compiled. Usually the cheapest, and they're really, you know, they're making some sense of your financials, but really the onus is on you to make sure that it's correct. Reviewed, I'm gonna go to the other end and say audited. So audited is you send over your financials to your accountant and they put it together along with your tax returns. And because of the money that you pay them, it's usually super expensive. You transfer the liability of an error on your tax returns over to the accountants. And the accountants will say, the sin is on my head if these statements are misstated or if there's any fraud involved. That's why audited statements cost so much. But from a buyer's perspective, audited statements are the most safe because they've got a third party out there that's saying this company has squeaky clean financials. The middle one is what we call reviewed. And reviewed is when your accountant compiles all that information and they put together your financial statements and your tax returns and they do a couple of tests, sanity checks is what we call them. And they say, yeah, these all look pretty much right and we're feeling pretty good about it. The difference between reviewed and audited is the fact that audited takes the responsibility and puts it onto the accounting firm effectively. But reviewed, it still stays with you. Here's the secret though. When your financials are reviewed, all right, and that type of engagement, we can sell that as an investment bank. We can sell that as almost audited. And that adds a huge amount of value because it reduces the risk to the buyer. And the way that I say it to the buyers is, hey, my client has reviewed financials. And they're like, oh, okay, we're still gonna do a Q of E, we're still gonna do a quality of earnings. But at the same time, because they know that your accountants were in there, probably less risk of financial shenanigans going along. Compiled, where they're just putting the numbers together, you know, that adds a lot more risk to it. And obviously audited is the safe, but the thing about auditing and having audited statements is it's going to be super expensive. And I can look just at your accounting costs, nothing else, and I can tell whether or not you got audited statements or not, because I will see that number in there. So do whatever you can. If you want to maintain that high multiple, do whatever you can to focus in on clean financials and good business practices. So now we go to the revenue bridge, okay? Crossing the revenue bridge. And this really centers around your customers and your business. And so what happens is when you go to sell your company, your customer relationships are critically important. And buyers are looking for very specific things. They are looking that you have a wide swath of customers. If you have any customer concentration issues, that is a very high risk proposition. Okay. So if you have a customer that represents more than 20% of your revenue, or a customer that represents 20% of your EBITDA, your net earnings, then you're going to want to sell that down as a percentage. Go get other clients, right? Because you will get banged up on your valuation due to customer concentration issues. I was negotiating this just last night with a PEO that we're selling down south. And it is because almost 80% of their revenue comes from four customers. And the balance of it comes from another 21. And the buyers are like, well, you know, if they lose any one of those four, then our investment kind of goes away. So one of the metrics that you're going to want to look at on a regular basis, especially coming in through your business development guys, not so much for your recruiters, but definitely your business development guys, is making sure that you are expanding your client base and you are not, the tail is not wagging the dog, that you have multiple clients that are out there and ameliorating some of that risk. But now let's talk about that revenue bridge and that plan that's going out, all right? You're also looking at a mix of industries that are served. If you are only in the food industry or hospitality, poor hospitality, I feel so horrible for the hospitality folks because they have just gotten crushed in the last year. But if they had a concentration in hospitality, you saw those companies, they're all on the edge. If you can have a mix of industry served, that's better because that also diversifies away from that concentration issue. In the same breath, the revenue bridge, what that is this. Last March, we were all at this revenue, okay? And then most of us either got banged up by 20%, 30%, and you know, sometimes a little bit more, and it tanked down to here. And we're not yet fully recovered. We can see the end of the tunnel, but we're not fully recovered there. What a revenue bridge is this. It is analyzing your accounts and being able to demonstrate that you are going to be able to get from last March back to that high water mark and where it's coming from in terms of your customers. How many are returning? How many are upticking? And what is what we call the go-get number, the number of new clients that you have to get to make up the difference between the ones that went out of business and are no longer your clients? How are you going to create that revenue bridge so that way we can value your company almost on a future look, right? And say, you know, we're not selling it on the lowest point. The stronger your revenue bridge, the stronger your plan, the stronger your ties are with your clients, and making sure that your team are the ones who are managing those client relationships, not you, all right? Your team, that is going to add, or at least in this case now, protect part of that valuation. If there's any weakness there, you're going to get banged up on the multiple that you have. Pretty clear on that one, okay? I want to reemphasize this. The biggest throw of the dice that you can have is trying to go into to sell your company with a customer concentration. That is absolutely like betting it all on Black 17 and just saying, I want to sell my company and I've got two customers that represent X percentage, 80% of my business. That's dangerous. It can happen if those customers are super important, you know, to the buyer and they have no customer concentration issues. But man, going to market like that is really, really tough. Try to keep it below 20% of revenue or 20% of EBITDA. Just make your life and our lives a lot easier that way. All right. Don't gamble it. The next one is what we call is scalable processes and procedures. I cannot begin to tell you how important this is. And what we're talking about in scalable is that you have, if you continued running the company, that you had a pathway to growing out the company. This is what the buyers want to hear. The buyers want to hear that, you know, you, the company itself could actually grow out into other markets and other services. And they want to see that you are in fact scalable. And so a lot of times that'll come down to the technology that you're serving, the connections you have within industries, or it's an uptick in an industry and you're perfectly placed there to take advantage of growth of a particular industry. We are especially seeing this in tech staffing firms that focus in on cybersecurity. If you can imagine that right now, that market just looks absolutely huge. And a year and a half ago, didn't look so much, but now it absolutely does. So one of the important things for you too is to document everything that you do. You're onboarding somebody for your program or your process, make sure that you have that documented down. You are bringing on a new recruiter and you need to train them up, make sure that your training process is down. The closing for your books every month, make sure that you've got that down. Human resources manuals. Everything that you can do to document your business reduces risk to the buyer. Because in the back of their mind, what they're thinking to themselves is this: what if you step off the curb and get hit by the beer truck? Who's going to run this thing now? And as long as you have it all documented, It doesn't eliminate the risk, but it certainly does start to minimize that risk, or at least reduce it to some degree. So making sure that you have got processes and procedures locked down and they're explainable and you can hand them over to a guy like me who's going to hand them off to a buyer, you know, after the NDAs are signed, you know, and we're getting to agreements. I will tell you, it can significantly add to the valuation of a company. If you're the chef that's just throwing stuff in a pan and it happens to come out great, but you don't have a cookbook, you're risking an awful lot. Make sure you not only have the cookbook, but make sure your sous chefs, all the people around you, are also cooking from it as well. So the other thing is that your competitors are important, and keeping an eye on your competitors. So what I would tell you is this: are you a niche business, and do you know who your competitors are? How well do you understand them? How well can you articulate the marketplace? When I put you in front of a buyer, does the company, your team, and you, do you understand the market so well that you can articulate what's coming at you from a blind side? Do you have an idea of where the company could grow, or the technologies that are currently serving you, or that are coming in on the horizon? You know, be it bots, chatbots, be it, you know, any of the technologies that you're having in terms of CRMs and management of both labor and clients. And what are your competitors doing as well? A lot of times what we don't see is that everybody's like, well, I don't really have any competitors. Nonsense. And now a lot of staffing companies are starting to see some of the bigger competitors, like the Wonolos of the world, or the Swipe Jobs of the world, or some of these digital platforms that look a lot like Uber. They might not necessarily have, you know, be up to speed just yet, but certainly they are coming. So you've got to keep an eye on your competitors and know your competitors and be able to speak to the competitors as well. And then the more important thing is right down in that corner where I said benchmarking your competitors. It is very important for you to know your gross margin relative to the industry. Is your gross margin higher than the industry average for the vertical that you're in? Whether or not you're in locum tenens, whether or not you're in travel nursing, doesn't matter if you're in tech or light industrial or any of those, what do your margins look like to the industry as a whole? Because at that point, what we see a lot of times is that people go for the big client. Why? Because it adds a huge amount of top line. The bill rates are great, and you know, they put it out there, but their margins get squeezed, and as a result, that averages down the margin of all those little clients that are actually paying more. And so if a buyer is looking at you versus your competitors and say, man, your operating margins are a lot different than your competitors, that's something that you ought to be at least benchmarking and looking at and keeping an eye on. Because if your ratios, if your benchmarks are better than the industry averages, you become a lot more attractive. And because of that, companies, if they don't already pay a premium for your company, they're at least not going to discount that multiple rate. So those are five things that you can do right now to be able to start addressing the valuation of your company. Very, very clear about it. Okay. So the question then becomes is, oh my God, this was so much data. This is so much information. I'm going to have to watch this webinar yet again, right? Make sure I get all the notes down. All right, I'll be out with that. All right. But getting ready for liftoff, whether or not you're going to sell your company 3 years from now, or whether or not you and I are going to be talking, you know, in the next month or two, because you want to try to get out by the end of the year before cap gains goes up, you're going to be saying to yourself, where do I start? Where do I start really improving my company to be able to maximize what we're going to get out of it? It's frankly, it's a lot easier than most people realize. Right. And I set it up this way. It's what I call the wheel of valuation. Okay. The wheel of valuation. And if at the center of the wheel of valuation, if that is 0% and the outside spoke is at 100%. Okay. And those percentages are quality. Okay. I'm at 0% quality, or I'm at 100% quality, or even what you say, satisfaction with what I think I can get in the market. What you're going to do is you're going to put a dot on the spoke under each one of those, in terms of your percentage of satisfaction or your percentage of dissatisfaction, you can even talk about to be inversely related with that particular item on the valuation. So let's just say that your EBITDA, you're only about 50% happy with your EBITDA because you realize that coming through COVID, you probably could have negotiated a lower rent, or you probably could have cut a couple people loose a little bit earlier, but now you're kind of getting there. Put a 50% satisfaction on that EBITDA. Your reputation is pretty amazing. And you got a couple of bang ups with some clients, maybe you got fired once or twice, but you're at about 80 or 90% on that. Put a dot at 89% or 80 or 90% of your satisfaction with that particular part. Do you have signed agreements with your clients, or are you just shipping them when they're starting to call? How tight are those agreements? Are they evergreen assignments? Do they have a transferability, meaning a transfer of ownership clause in them? Have you reviewed those agreements? Maybe, maybe not. So on and so, take a look at your size and growth. Does it meet the kind of the benchmarks against other people within your industry? Are you happy with it? Are you at 60%? Are you better than 90% of the industry? Do you have a niche, or are you an also ran? Maybe you're super niche-y because those command usually a premium, and you might be 95 on that one. Do you have a diversified customer base? Yes, I'm getting revenue from everyone. Your customer is up higher. The point being, on the wheel of valuation, just put a dot on your level of satisfaction with each one of those areas. And then the magic comes when you start connecting those dots. Then you ask yourself a really simple question. Would my wheel roll? Would it roll? Would it go around? And if the answer to that is no, then it is exactly like running your car. You can see where your tire is the most flat and go ahead and start addressing that issue. And 90% of the time, what we see is going to be both on the customer base, the management team, and then to some degree on the EBITDA. And that's normally where most companies have a degree of flat tire. Maybe the company is too dependent on the CEO, the founder, the owner, and their management team is not strong enough and they're pretty flat there. Wherever your tire is the flattest, that's where you go to work. Think of this analogy. You get a flat tire on the side of the highway. First thing you do is you pull over, right? But in business, we can't pull over. All we do is keep going, right? We got to fix it while the car is moving. But the idea is you're trying to be able to get the spare on. Most people don't carry a full spare. Most people carry a donut. So all we want to do is to be able to get those things round first, all those spokes round first, and then we get down to the gas station and we put the full spare on and we get it all the way out there as close to 100 as we possibly can. So where do you start? Real simple. Take an inventory of these things that are going to materially impact your valuation, and where you're most flat, go to work on those things. So in the few minutes that we have remaining, I want to share with you a couple of things, one of which is your transaction team, and the second, some of the cardinal sins of selling your company. And then we'll open it up to additional questions if you guys have any. And we'll bring Amanda back on as well. When you go to sell your company, there are four people that you're really going to rely on. And what I would tell you is the best transactions that we have, like the one I was working on this morning, they have their team in place in advance, and they know who their team is, and they have rapport with them. It just makes an awful lot of sense. So the first one I'm going to start with is your accountant, okay? Your accountant is part of your team. They're standing there right with you. Now, they're not always happy that you're selling the company because they're going to lose a client, but they also have a fiduciary responsibility. So it's important that you let your accountant know, you know, what your game plans are, especially because from your net worth standpoint, they're going to be helping you out with that and the tax consequences of it. The second is your attorney. And I'm not talking about your DWI attorney. I'm not talking about your marital attorney or the attorney that got your kid off of a trespassing charge because he decided to tube down a river in front of somebody else's house. Talk about that one another time. But You're talking about a transaction attorney, all right? You're talking about somebody who knows the staffing space and somebody who knows the law around mergers and acquisitions. So you want to be able to identify that person relatively early because they are going to be very important in managing your risk. The next one is your money manager. I'm going to wire you $20 million, $30 million, $3 million, whatever the amount of money I'm going to wire you, your money manager has got to know that it's coming and they've got to be able to plan for your progeny and everybody else that's going along with that. Don't leave them out of the loop. Make sure that your money manager knows that the money's coming and it's going to be coming in a year or two so they can have your portfolio balanced so that way you can live on the money that I get you. More than one occasion, I've had sellers go broke in the couple of years after they sold because they didn't necessarily have a plan. And then finally, your investment banker. And your investment banker, it doesn't matter if it's me, it could be someone. Have an intermediary of some kind. There's a study done, I'll send it to you if you like, along with another offer that I've got for you. But in 100% of cases, the investment banker actually added significant amount of value to the sales process, not just because it's a reduction in stress, but also because it facilitates the transaction a lot easier. And normally we're going to be able to negotiate the purchase price up and the terms up non-emotionally. And that makes a huge difference. So be on the lookout for your team. Doesn't matter if you use us, love for you to call us, but use somebody, okay? Use somebody and make sure you like them and you trust them. Real quick, some of the critical mistakes sellers often make, they have inflated expectations. And by the way, this is Chris Moneymaker. He was an accountant who actually ended up winning the World Series of Poker a few years back. But he did not gamble it all the way. But the critical mistakes that sellers make, inflated expectations. My company is worth far more than I think it is. Get a valuation done, get it done by an investment banker because they are absolutely looking at it from a market perspective and they've got some dynamics on there. Sometimes you're too rigid on the terms that you're asking for, just rigid and saying, no, I have to have this or I have to have that. And I will tell you, when selling your company, rigidity is your enemy. And it causes more deals to blow up than I can possibly tell you. And normally you got to ask yourself, am I really willing to die on that particular hill? Another sin of selling is easing up when you're in the middle of the process. Oh, that's okay. You want your foot to the floor driving 1,000,000 miles an hour until the day that I wire you all your money and the company is no longer yours. Keep pushing it, making sure that your team is going. Don't wait for the prom queen. Don't wait for the perfect buyer. Everybody has in their mind this perfect buyer and they click 5 of the boxes, but not the 6th one. So we'll keep looking. It's just, that is a formula for misery. We're going to put in front of you 6-10 buyers. You're going to pick one from there. It doesn't have to be perfect. It just has to be pretty good. Then the next one is that one of the sins is that people don't heed the advice. When you hire your investment banker, there's two fees that go along with that. The first is going to be a retainer. All right. I will tell you, somebody who doesn't charge you a retainer, be suspect. Somebody who charges you more than, I don't know, pick a number, 50 grand, also be suspect depending on the size of your company. But the point of the matter is you're going to pay a retainer. Usually it's going to be around, $10,000-$15,000. And then they don't listen to the advice. And we sit there and we scratch our heads and we're like, we just spent an hour on a webinar. Why didn't you do the things that we asked you to do? Especially when you're going through some of the negotiations. Don't gamble it by not listening to people. We do so many of these transactions every year. Just listen to what we have to say, right? You're ultimately in control. We got to do what you're asking us to do. But, if you're going to pay somebody to sell your company, listen to what they have to say, right? I am going to give you a special gift. If you take down my email address right there, my partner, Jonathan Brabrand, he wrote a phenomenal book called The $100 Million Exit, The Roadmap to the Ultimate Payday. And anybody who wants a copy of this book, you send me a way to get it to you. I am going to have Susan in our front office go ahead and get that out to you today. And I am happy to do it. I wish I could say that I wrote it, but he obviously just took a lot more time than I did to do it. But everything in that book is probably part of what it is, what I was talking about on this today. And we'll absorb the cost for that. That is all for you. We have about a minute for questions. Amanda, I am sorry, but I was trying to land the plane on time. And if anybody has any questions and we have the time, we'll take it. If not, they can send me an email at that same address and we'll get it done.
Sounds great. So again, if you have any questions, you can use the Q&A or chat feature, or you can go ahead and either email myself directly or Patrick, you know, we can get you his information if you want to talk one-on-one about any questions that you have. Great presentation. You covered so much very useful information today, you know, kind of at lightning speed for us, you know, a good value of the hours spent. Definitely appreciate the book offer. That's very kind of you for our audience today.
It's okay. I stole them out of Jonathan's office, so we're all good.
Yeah, he won't know. He's totally okay with it. Well, good. So really, thank you so much for joining us in our webinar series to cover this important topic for our clients. We will have a recording on our website at tricom.com for anyone who wants to view it again, or certainly share it with others that you may know in the industry. So with that, I think we can close up today's session. And thank you again so much. Certainly appreciate your time today.
You bet. I really enjoyed it, and I appreciate the opportunity. And I hope everybody got something out of it and at least brighten their day a little bit. Be ambitious. Do the right thing. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you so much.